sponsored by Surfshark VPN. Rare earth metals and other minerals are essential for green tech like EVs and renewable energy. Trouble is, we need a lot of them, and their availability on Earth is limited. But what if we could tap into all those materials flying around in space? Some scientists claim we could mine asteroids in the future. Yes, asteroids. Is it just an Armageddon remake, or will we eventually dig into them? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. So what will we mine in the future? Asteroids? The moon? Or should we just stick with the Earth? The problem with that last option is that the Earth's mining resources will run out sooner or later. How long will that take? Well, for certain metals and elements, it could be less than 50 years, according to some estimates. For example, indium, which is a crucial rare earth element used for thin film solar panels, it may disappear in the space of 18 years. What about platinum? You might know that fuel cell electric vehicles rely on it as a catalyst. Well, if we converted 500 million vehicles over to fuel cells, we would run out of platinum within 15 years to keep them operating. And that's including recycling along with mining new platinum. You can probably see why it makes sense to look around for alternative supplies. And I know space mining may sound like sci-fi talk at the moment, but what if I told you we could mine on the moon by using solar power? No pickaxe, no Bruce Willis, nothing else. Or that we could just literally bag an asteroid and suck the water and elements out of it to use as rocket fuel. But before exploring the most futuristic ideas of space mining, let's try to figure out its viability compared to Earth mining. According to NASA, the cost of an asteroid mining mission is about $2.6 billion. Now, this estimate is based on a Keck Institute for Space Studies, or KISS, feasibility analysis. And KISS's study studied the capture of a 500-ton C-type near-Earth asteroid and its transport into a high lunar orbit. These types of asteroids are key for space colonization as they contain water and other elements, which can be used as fuels. But how do you capture such a massive rolling stone? Well, just stick with the KISS rule. Well, maybe it's not as simple as that, but matching the asteroid rotation speed, a robotic spacecraft would use its solar electric propulsion to de-spin it and enclose it with a container. The unit would then carry the giant rock into high lunar orbit. The study authors claimed that the operation would be feasible by 2025 as long as we achieve three things. One, identify more asteroids that can be brought back near the Earth. Two, improve the solar electric propulsion technology to reduce the transport time. And three, build up human settlements on the moon. Now, if this sounds out of reach, remember that just 6 years ago, the Rosetta spacecraft managed to land on a 2.5-mile-wide comet. Now, NASA's estimate of $2.6 billion might sound like a crazy amount of money for asteroid mining, but we need to put that in perspective. Setting up a rare earth metal mine, let's say for platinum, would cost about $1 billion. Now, obviously, that's cheaper than going to space, but according to Planetary Resources, we could get up to about $50 billion worth of platinum out of a 98-foot asteroid. Now that sounds great, right? But as you might expect, things are a little bit more complicated. The cost of transporting resources from space to Earth is astronomical. It's about $35,000 per kilogram of platinum based on a profitability analysis. This study considered platinum because it'd be worth space hunting due to its high value to mass ratio. Their model also addressed the effect of different factors on mining feasibility, like price elasticity. They also considered the introduction of space-based platinum into the Earth market and the resulting decrease in terrestrial production. Overall, they show that mining asteroids and returning platinum to Earth is profitable only in a few unlikely cases. Now, researchers suggest increasing the mining efficiency and upscaling the production of small spacecraft as key drivers to improve the economics of platinum mining on asteroids. And also, reusable spacecraft would maximize profit. SpaceX has shown how big an impact reusability can have with spaceflight. Relaunching their flight-proven Falcon rockets has saved Space Force $52.7 million. I still have trouble saying Space Force without rolling my eyes. Now, in terms of asteroids that are available for mining, a study by the National Space Society said that 10% of the known NEAs are more accessible than the moon, and 50% of them may bear water and hydrocarbons. So what about mining the lunar surface? There's some interesting stuff happening there, but before I get to that, let's talk about something a little closer to home. I'd like to thank Surfshark for sponsoring this video. Now, I always recommend using a VPN when you're on public Wi-Fi, but VPNs can be very useful even when you're at home. A lot of online services use some pretty sophisticated commercial targeting and tracking, and a VPN can protect you from that. Surfshark's clean web does a great job blocking ads, trackers, and malicious websites, and making it safer to use the internet even at home. And you can even make it look like your IP address is coming from a completely different country. This can come in handy if you want to stream a video that's only available from a specific location. One of the best parts of Surfshark is that it's easy to set up on all of your devices, whether that's iPhone or Android, Mac or PC. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account to use with an unlimited number of devices. Use my code to get 83% off and 3 extra months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. Link in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. So what about the lunar surface? The lunar exploration company iSpace has launched the Hakuto program, the first of a series of missions that's scheduled for next year, which will land the very first robotic spaceship ever on the lunar surface. In the 2 years after that, a second mission will follow with a rover testing for lunar water. And yes, water is what they're mostly interested in. There's up to tens of billions of metric tons of water in the form of permafrost and ice on the moon's poles. Water is going to be the oil of space industrialization. Besides quenching astronauts' thirst, water is the source of hydrogen which can be used to propel rockets. But there's an even cooler way to get fuel out of water. The Silicon Valley startup is using photosynthesis. Feeding CO2, water, and electricity to an electrolysis cell, Opus 12 can generate methane. And liquid methane is the SpaceX Raptor engine's favorite drink. Also, they can implement this process directly on the moon or on Mars, where you can get plenty of carbon dioxide out of the air. This would help overcome one of the major limitations for space missions, which is fuel availability. Cislunar space could become a space gas station. But water isn't the only precious thing that we could get from the moon. According to Dr. Carlos Espejel, a mining industry veteran and engineer at iSpace, the lunar surface could harbor plenty of rare earth elements too. Another driver for moon scavenging is helium-3. And this is not the gas that makes your voice sound funny after sucking it out of a birthday balloon. It's a rare isotope that accounts for about 0.001% of all the helium on Earth. The side note of why that's interesting is because we could feed helium-3 to future fusion reactors and make nuclear power safer and more eco-friendly. It's because this helium isotope isn't radioactive and wouldn't generate toxic waste. But that's a completely different video. Now, clearly, moon resources would be strategic not only for our planet's sustainability, but also for near-Earth and deep space exploration. But are we promising ourselves the moon? Ian Crawford, who's a professor of planetary science and astrobiology, thinks we are. He doubts the economic viability of mining the moon, mostly because of the astronomical cost of transporting the ore back to Earth. Crawford thinks we'd be better off building up new renewable energy facilities on our planet. And a case study from Bocconi's School of Management assessed the feasibility of lunar ice mining for propellant production. The researchers estimated that the overall cost of exploring moon ice reserves, developing mining infrastructures, and bringing back the water to Earth to be around $7 billion. Even though we may be light years away from making it cost effective, the space mining market could be worth trillions of dollars. For example, NASA valued a single asteroid at more than the global economy. The asteroid is called 16 Psyche and is predominantly made of iron and nickel. NASA is planning to reach its surface in 2026 to take a closer look. Although this rolling rock isn't a near-Earth asteroid because it's between Mars and Jupiter. Also keep in mind that this rich asteroid would turn into a cheap stone here on Earth. That's because flooding our market with that amount of materials would decrease their value. It's only worth that much because it's out there where we can't get to it. And that raises an interesting point. There's a balance between cost, value, and utility. These asteroids have a value in part because their materials they contain are in finite supply here on Earth. But flooding the market with that large supply reduces their value. However, there is utility in the material itself. Going right back to the previous example of platinum, aside from its use in jewelry, if we need it to support energy production as a catalyst in fuel cells, tapping into additional resources from space mining would be needed for the utility, even though it might drive down the monetary value. But that's a moot point if we aren't making the technological advances necessary to make space mining a reality, which we actually are. TransAstra is priming the pump to get water out of the moon's surface. They developed a lunar polar gas dynamic mining outpost architecture. Their rovers, which are powered by solar panels, would heat the permafrost covering the lunar craters with a combo of radio frequencies, microwave, and infrared light. This radiation mix would produce water vapor, which then gets captured by cryotraps and stored in a liquid form. TransAstra technology could drive down the cost of setting up and maintaining a lunar polar station. This will make life easier for future explorers and lays the groundwork for development of settlements like lunar hotels. TransAstra has also been busy developing their APIS project to mine near-Earth asteroids. After running small-scale experiments on their Mini-Bee, they'll upgrade to two larger spacecraft, Honeybee and Queenbee. The Queen should be able to handle an asteroid of about 40 meters in diameter. The way these craft work is that they bag up an asteroid and suck out the water and other elements that can be used as propellants for rockets. So what's special about the system? Well, the company's designed two groundbreaking technologies. The first is the Omnivore Thruster, which is the propulsion system for all of their spacecraft. As the name suggests, its key advantage is that it can consume a wide range of fuels, from ammonia, hydrogen, and above all, water. As the ship travels back to Earth, they take a small portion of the mined water they've collected to use as their own fuel. The system injects the water into a ceramic sponge, and when sunlight hits the porous ceramic insert, water vaporizes and flows out through a nozzle, giving the spacecraft thrust. The second innovation is called optical mining. Using very large, thin-film solar panels, their device reflects solar light and focuses it onto the captured rock to fracture it and pull out the water. The highly concentrated sunlight is lighter, less expensive, and better performing than electric power. But it's time to come back down to Earth. Although very promising, these technologies are still a long way from being upscaled. In the meantime, we may have alternatives closer to home than we might think, like right in our houses. A recent study reports that using copper and gold recycled from waste TV sets to be more cost-effective than mining for new materials. Apple designed a robot to extract valuable materials from discarded iPhones, including rare earth metals. Their creation, Daisy, goes through 3.33 phones per minute. And it's not just a small-scale thing. The urban mining company is producing thousands of tons of magnets per year using rare earth metals recycled from e-waste. While technological advancements and eco-friendly fuels such as water and CO2 may make asteroids and the moon within reach for mining, it will take quite a bit of time for space mining to become a viable thing. Also, just like the Earth, asteroids and other planets have finite resources. Whichever future mining path we end up on, recycling and reuse will always need to be a necessary component. So do you think space mining is going to be a major source for us in the future? Or should we just stick closer to home? Jump in the comments and let me know. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I've linked to right here. Be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. And as always, thanks to all of my patrons and to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.